May we please request for the congregation to rise to their feet.
Behold!
Thank you, family and friends. While you remain standing, it is my privilege to call upon Pastor Errol Hartley to open this celebration service of the life of Tim Nair in a word of prayer. Pastor Errol Hartley.
Let's just pray together. Our loving Heavenly Father, we stand in your presence this morning, and we're actually awed by what a great God you are. And we just want to focus on your greatness today. When we think of Tim, Lord, we think of the incredible work that you have done in this man's life. Everything that he became is because of your work and the work of your Holy Spirit within the life of this wonderful man who is dedicated to you and who wanted to follow you and just be what you wanted him to be. And so as we come together and we remind ourselves of what you have done in his life, I pray that we might be challenged to live likewise, that we might be challenged to just yield to you and to listen to your voice as you lead us and to dedicate ourselves to be followers of Jesus Christ the way Tim was. And so, Lord, I pray for the family, and I pray for those who are mourning. I pray for those whose hearts are sore and who are aching this morning. And I want to thank you for the comfort that your Holy Spirit is able to give us. And I just pray that they might experience your nearness at this time, and that pain, that heartache will just dissipate. And so, dear Lord, we've come to rejoice because of a life that has been incredibly well lived. And Lord, we just commit all those to you who are mourning at this time in Jesus' name. Bless the service, I pray, every part of it. And through it all, may Jesus Christ be uplifted. Yes. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you, Pastor Errol. You may be seated. Dearly beloved family and friends, we are gathered here today to celebrate the life of a dear Son of God, a disciple of Christ, a father, a husband, a grandfather, an uncle, a friend, and a stalwart to me, Nair. My name is Logan Maestri, and I'm married to the eldest niece of Uncle Tim, Yvonne, and it's my privilege to be the MC at this celebration service today, because indeed, Uncle Tim played an integral part in our lives. Our thoughts and prayers are with his dear wife, Mumsy, his children, Mervyn, Melissa, Quinton and Kaylin, son-in-law, Roshan, his grandchildren, Taryn, Miguel, and Liam, his siblings, Ronnie, Peter, David, James, Prissy, and a host of other family from the Nair and Reddy families. The Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Also, we are on the earth, but we are not of this earth. We are the heavens of the Lord. Uncle Tim is part of the heavens of the Lord. When I think of Uncle Tim, three distinct characteristics of Christ stood out for me through his life. My pastor always says that if we had to give God another name, we will give God the name Give. And I think that sums up the life of Uncle Tim. He was a giver. And so it's giving, it's prudence, and it's wisdom. With Jesus Christ as his lover, Uncle Tim was never greatly shaken. Uncle Tim inherited the covenant blessings of the Lord. Uncle Tim was righteous, and his life was loaded with wisdom. His words were not crooked. His words were not perverse. Words that bring delight poured out from his lips continuously. He reflected the glory, the nature, and the character of Christ. Even in death, Uncle Tim's life still speaks to us. It is said that the tragedy of life is not death, but living life without a purpose. It is also said that it is the living who close the eyes of the dead, and the dead who opens the eyes of the living. As we celebrate Uncle Tim's life today, may our eyes be opened as Uncle Tim's life testifies that Christ is the way, Christ is the truth, and Christ is the life. Through Uncle Tim's life today, we say, let his kingdom come and let his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We look forward to the celebration today, and we know that all of heaven rejoices with us as we celebrate this life of a disciple of Christ, a son of God who showed us how to live life to its fullest. Well, this morning, I would like to now invite you to the viewing. We will now have an opportunity for the viewing as a time to reflect and spend these last moments together with Uncle Tim and his loved ones. Please bear in mind that it is imperative that we observe all COVID-19 and related protocols, which includes social distancing and no touching and hugging. And in line with these protocols, may we also kindly request that you please refrain from greeting and sympathizing with the family at this stage. Those in the chapel will also not be part of the viewing at this stage, but we will afford you an opportunity during the committal later today. May I kindly request that in line with COVID-19 and related protocols, those on my right and at the back of the auditorium move in an orderly fashion to the front for the viewing, and thereafter others may follow. I'm sure the pallbearers and the funeral undertakers will assist us accordingly. Thank you. Thank you. We would now afford you an opportunity from the back on my right to please proceed for the viewing. Thank you.
Didn't know today would be your last, or that I'd have to say goodbye to you so fast. I'm so numb I can't feel anymore. I'm praying you'd just walk back through that door and tell me that I was only dreaming. You're not really gone as long as I believe. There will be another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight.
If everyone on my right is finished, we can proceed to the left. If anyone on the left would like to view, please do so as well. Thank you.
Always made my troubles feel so small, and you were always there to catch me when I'd fall. In a world where heroes come and go, well, God just took the only one I know. So I'll hold you as close as I can, longing for the day when I see your face again. But until then, God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight, singing hallelujah.
If anybody else would like to view the face, you're also more than welcome to please come and view the face. Thank you.
Still God.
still God. Though I can't see what's before me, I know that I can trust your heart. And this one truth will be my story. You still reign and you're still
come a bright tomorrow, when the world will all be free from sin and strife.
Do not shun the Savior's love from up in glory, or you won't be there to sing the gospel story.
In my Father's house are many mansions. If you're true, then to this land you'll surely go.
I shudder to think what would have happened to Jimmy Swaggart. My parents had not found Jesus Christ, but mercy rewrote my life.
For years I traveled a road all wrong. My heart had lost its joy and its song. Then grace placed me right where I belong. When mercy
my mistakes that day returned into miracles. He reached up and wiped away the tears and turned them somehow into joy.
My past sins were forgiven, a new name was written.
Yes, it did.
Cast way down,
but mercy rewrote my life. I could have fallen, my soul cast away down, but mercy, His mercy rewrote. Thank you, Lord, my life. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Thank you. And that was really the story of Uncle Timmy's life. Mercy rewrote his life. And so today, whilst we mourn, as Pastor told us earlier on, we don't mourn without, as those without hope. We mourn with hope. And we want to take chapters and lessons from Uncle Timmy's life. So we are also here today to celebrate his life. And this is a celebration service to celebrate the legacy that he's left. Now, if you know Uncle Timmy, he loves singing, and he loves singing hymns. So we're going to do that today as a tribute to him. We're going to sing a few hymns and really, really make sure that we celebrate this man that has left such an indelible mark on all our lives. And we know that heaven rejoices today as this son, who's a mature son, a perfect son, one who has walked in the completeness and the wholeness of Christ. That's the life we celebrate today. So I'd like for you to stand as we sing the first hymn on our hymn sheets, and that is What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often find. Take it to
You. We thank you, Father, that, Lord, you are our peace. We thank you, Father, that you are our hope. And we thank you for the life of Uncle Tim. We rejoice today that, Lord, he is finished and he has finished his race well. And may those of us who are left behind also take a leaf from his book and finish our race well. To you be all the glory, the honor, and the praise. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You may be seated, family. Thank you. We now have the privilege of listening to a few tributes about this remarkable life of a man who has done so much in his time on the earth. Not that he never had challenges. He overcame many obstacles, many, many, many challenges, and was able to finish his race well. I'm now going to call upon Billy Lauterhan, who is an elder of the church and also the manager of Nedbank, to pay a tribute to Uncle Tim Nair. Billy.
Morning, afternoon, I should say. Mumsy, to your family, to your extended family and friends from Sharon and myself, and on behalf of the leadership and congregation of Norwegian Settlers Church, and from our Nedbank staff and other friends, we extend our heartfelt sympathies to you all. I've been asked to say a few words, which I regard as a privilege. Today is a sad day for us all, but as Logan has shared, it is also a victory because Tim lives today. When we got the news of Tim's passing, I recall saying to myself, oh no, he was on the road to recovery. And then the message said further, he has gone to be with his Lord. And I reread the message. And then a sense of peace came over me, as we know that those words in itself is the final comfort for those who know that promise. Whenever I've been asked to pay tribute to someone, it really reminds me that when one gives thought to that, that God has uniquely designed each one of us as an individual person. Many will stand here and say things about people. The words may be repetitive. They become like a cliche. But somehow when you put your mind to it and your thoughts to it, each word becomes a special connection to that person. And every person themselves, you can't explain it. It's an emotional connection, and that's how I feel about it today. I met him when we first came down here in the early 90s, mid-90s, and it was pre-Mr. Cool. And then we, as a bank, was part of Nedbank, we managed to walk a road with him, and it's good to see Vanita here, I think. And I recall sometime into his new venture, he said to me, and there was somehow he used to say to me, hey, Bill, it was never with the I, with the U, when is Nedbank going to ask us to be a vendor for them? And let me tell you, to become a vendor for a bank is tough. It's got some hard demands. But anyway, we tried, and then one day I managed to get the procurement officer to come and visit down at Port Shepstone, and all he said was after that is, what a professional, well-run set up that displays trust and reliability. Let us accept them on board. And I must say, for Mr. Koo, that is an accolade through Tim's leadership. Tim and myself had a great client-bank relationship which became a friendship, and which is more, I observed that his team emulated his ethic. It is always a pleasure dealing with Mr. Cool. Integrity in business today is tough. Playing the game right is challenging. To remain positive in business is tough these days. And often he would share his thoughts with me, but he would always end with, "We must do what the Bible says we must do. And we must look up, as he is in control." Many businessmen here know the struggles. Taking responsibility to keep people in employment, that in itself is a challenge. And the responsibility leans heavy on the owners. And Tim accepted that responsibility. He ran his business with Christian principles, taking responsibility to keep people in the game and to do their work as unto the Lord. He had a high standard for excellence, and he knew what he wanted. And let us not excuse that, as he also had that empathetic and caring side, very generous and yet private. It was always good to visit Tim, because he spoke about many other things bar the business. A few years back, Tim called me to discuss a church matter he needed guidance with. And after that long discussion, it was very evident that I grew to hear the heart of Tim as God's servant. It also made me realize more that we in God's family, we are all connected in the heart with a common thread of Christ in us. It was a warm, encouraging, and deep spiritual conversation that I will never forget. And what came out of there was a sense of brotherly love that developed. And this is what the scriptures teach us, to have this love for one another, no matter what church we go to. As I said, from there, I was always referred to as, "Hey, Bill, how are you, Boot?" And he would always stand up and greet me when I used to come the side there. Yet I was younger than him. The photo in the Herald, to me, depicts the distinguished gentleman he was. Positive, respectful of all, warm to talk to, and so much more. We all here prayed for him whilst he was in hospital. Our hopes were high. But God. We often hear this said in sermons from this pulpit, or we read it in the scriptures. And what can we say to that? And many ask why. And those of us who know him as Savior know that he is all-powerful and all-knowing. But God. And it sort of helps us understand to a degree. I'll close now and just refer to 1 Kings 17, 24. It says there, "Then the woman said to Elijah, 'Now by this I know that you are a man of God, and that the word of the Lord in your mouth is truth.' Then he, Elisha, arose and followed Elijah and became his servant." And I just had to ask myself, that was Tim. Can that be said of us? Port Shepstone has lost a truly humble citizen. husband, father, brother, friend, and as was said. But heaven, we know, has gained a son, as Logan has said. Because Christ, we know, would have said, as we have heard from this very pulpit 2 weeks ago, that at the moment of death here on earth, Tim left, and Christ would have said, I know Tim now, let him in. Bless you. Thank you.
Thank you, Billy. Indeed, as you said, Uncle Tim was a true gentleman, a rare gentleman, and we really want to celebrate his life today. It's now my privilege to call upon Vinesh Naidu, who was also Uncle Tim's bookkeeper, to pay a tribute. Vinesh.
My relationship with Tim spans a number of years, so it's a bit of a long one. Just bear with me. Good afternoon to the family and friends of Tim Naya. I am deeply honored to share a few words on behalf of my friend, my mentor, my voice of reason, my counsel, and a person I've used as a reference point in my life, Tim Naya. Tim was an uncomplicated man. His life revolved around the devotion to his family, his unquestionable belief in the Lord Jesus Christ, and the commitment to his business. I met Tim about 27 years ago, and then he showed a trust in me, a commitment, and a faith in me that still exists today. Qualities that I didn't even know I possessed back then. He gave me an opportunity where there was none. And over the past years, what started out as a business relationship has turned into a mutually respectful friendship. Tim's business prophecy is very simple. Success is only achieved through hard work. He was normally the first person at work, and he was normally the last person to leave. And he set the tone and standards and the work ethic for his business. You know, some may call it OCD, in that everything that happened at Mr. Cool had to pass through his desk. Over the years, I've learned that that practice is not about control. It's about accountability. He knew that success in his business will be attributable to Mr. Cool. But he also knew that failure will be a reflection on him. He took this responsibility of operating an ethical and principled business more seriously than anyone I have known. And hence his success was slow, but so rewarding. He would often attest that he sleeps well at night, knowing full well that what he has achieved in life is due to the efforts and perseverance that he has put in. Tim was a very wise and astute man. And I recall a few years back when he wanted to purchase a new vehicle because he was unhappy driving his C-Class to work and he wanted a more elevated driving position so that he could see the pedestrians on the road. And after about 3 or 4 months of research, because as you may well know, Tim ticks all the boxes, crosses all the puts all the X's, does all the due diligence before he commits. But when he commits, it's 100%. So Tim purchased this green SsangYong SUV. And I arrived at Mr. Cool, and I see this green monster parked in the parking spot. And my immediate reaction was, seriously, Tim? Anyway, he goes through the vehicle with me and he points out the Mercedes engine and all the safety features. And I just like, why? Why this car? And then he says, but this is the safest vehicle on the South Coast. Tim's route to work was from Albertville down the Sugar Mill Road through Marburg and through the busy intersection at Marburg. And he said, if you see this vehicle coming towards you and you are thinking about crossing the road, you better think twice. Because you know the driver of this vehicle is not too concerned about a damage to his vehicle. And if you, the pedestrian, happens to meet with this vehicle, it's gonna hurt. Secondly, who in their right mind would want to hijack me in this vehicle? Because no hijacker will want to be apprehended behind the wheel of this vehicle. I lost the argument. Over the past years, Tim and I have met at least once a month, around the 23rd, 24th of the month. And whenever I enter his office, he will always stand up. He will always give you this huge beaming smile. And he never shook your hand like this. It was always around the corner like that. And he'll greet you, offer you to something to drink before you even sit. He always took pride in his appearance. He's always neatly attired. You know, we will conclude our business, and then for about 20 to 30 minutes, we'll chat about life, family, cars, business, etc., etc. And during these conversations, I learned about Tim's commitment to Christianity. Tim always gave everything of himself in everything that he did, but none more than the commitment to his faith. He was a devout Christian, and he believed that we are on earth to do the Lord's work, and we must humble ourselves when we serve God. So when he had an issue at a previous church where he was an elder, and he had to deal with the conduct of the pastor, he was conflicted and in pain and anguish and battled to understand how a man appointed by God could behave in a selfish, self-serving manner. After numerous interventions, meetings, and prayers, he came to the conclusion that the established did not have the interests of the Lord at his core, and he left the church. Now, this incident, instead of denting his belief, it reinforced and cemented his belief even more. He felt he needed to be more, do more for his community, and he felt he needed to lead by example. Now, every December, without fail, irrespective of whether Mr. Kuhl makes a profit or a loss, he pays his staff a bonus. But he pays himself zero. He takes an equivalent amount to that bonus, and he would distribute in the form of food parcels to the needy, pays for improvement to the church. He even had an air conditioner installed, which he paid for. Not credited to a loan account, he paid for it. And you would think a guy who owns an air conditioning company, surely he can get an air conditioner. But he paid for it. And the reason he did that, because Tim said, and this is what is at the core of Tim, to sacrifice is only worth the effort if you had to endure the pain yourself. Because then only are you able to appreciate the fruits of your labor and be able to receive the Lord's blessings. To Mumsy, thank you for allowing him to be the man that he was. Tim could only go and make a difference in other people's lives because you were the rock that he gravitated from. He always said that you were an excellent cook, and he chose well. Because after a long day's work, all a man really needs is a good meal and a bit of conversation. To Quentin and Kaylin, your dad has given you the greatest gift possible. He's given you a blueprint of how to be a man, to be a responsible man, a principled man, an ethical man, a religious man, and a good father and a husband. I know that if you follow the example that your dad has laid out by the manner in which he lived his life, you will be successful, but more important, you'll be content. And you'll only understand this 20 to 30 years from now. that it's far more important in life to be content than to have all the money in the world. Your dad understood that life was about balance, and you need to lead a balanced life. When life throws you a curveball and you are complexed or perplexed, just ask yourself, what will your dad do? And the answer will reveal itself. Before I part, I would like to share my last conversation with Tim, which was our last act together. And it typifies the character of the man that he was. We had just concluded his salaries, albeit via phone, and Tim called me to thank me for the schedule, and more importantly, to forward my account for payment. In the 27 years that I've been Tim's accountant, I've never once had to pick up the phone and say, hey, Tim, please can you sort out my account? Because there was never a need to. My account was always paid timely. And, you know, my response to Tim, sorry, I've lost my track. My account was always paid timely. My response to Tim, I said, rest, recover from your illness, and I will see you next week, and I'll drop off the pay slips and give you the account, and you can sort it out. Tim doesn't listen to that. He paid the account, and that's what he was. And he paid without me furnishing an account. And he believed that you must pay for work done, not in 30 days, not in 60 days, but immediately once the work is done. Because that is correct business practice. But more importantly, it displays appreciation for the work that the person has done by making a timely payment. I, for one, will miss my friend. And I think God has taken one of the truly good human beings away. But he has left us with so many reference points that we cannot really go astray in life. You know, over the past year, the topic between Tim and I was about his retirement. He was turning 66 at the end of the year, and he said, now I need to spend more time with my wife and children. I think he knew he was going to rest, but I don't think even he knew what the Lord's plans for that rest was and where he was going to rest. In conclusion, rest in peace, my friend, and God bless your family. Thank you.
There it is again. Uncle Tim was a hard worker. Uncle Tim knew that you couldn't get things easy, and these are the values that society lacks today. And so it's our heart today that as we listen to these tributes, that we'll reinforce these true values that will make us a society that will come back to this reality of life, that fake living will not take us anywhere. Shortcuts will not take us anywhere. But really making sure that the nature and character of Christ, the demand of the heavens is imposed on the earth, is what will change our society. It's now my privilege to call upon another close friend of Uncle Timmy, Pastor Lazarus, to pay a tribute as well. Pastor Laz.
Thank you, Logan.
Greetings to all here today, to the esteemed great men and women of God who's gathered here today, to the fivefold ministry, and to Sister Mamsi and the family. I stand here this afternoon with mixed feelings and emotions. To see a great man of God, the saint of God, a marketplace leader in this casket today. Here lies a great man of God. When I heard of his illness, I became paranoid. And I quickly put a prayer request to everybody in Mount Edgecombe, Durban, and the Phoenix area, Verulam area, to the Widow's Mite Ministries, to intercede and pray, to the Haggai Institute, my colleagues, to the Missions Fellowships, to the Fraternals, our Gideon Ministries, and we interceded regarding his illness. And I realized that there was a tug of war going on between us, family, friends, the body of Christ, with God eternal. There was a tug of war going on in our intercession. God has his way. He won the battle. What a wonderful father, a great husband, a great leader in the marketplace, a soldier in the army of God, truly a gentleman indeed, precious and rare, a man of great giftings and talents, a person who was very relational and very rational in his thinking and also in analyzing. He was very forthright, very profound in his reasoning and discerning, which brought about amicable solutions. That's what a gifted man my brother was. He was a very seasoned, well-rounded individual. Loving, caring, compassionate, and with a very generous heart. His attire, the accountant spoke earlier on, his attire and his dressings was one of the attributes of what's inside of him, who he represents as King and his Guru, the Lord Jesus Christ. He was dedicated to his business, and as a provider for his family, and a great employer who gave much grace to his staff. He empowered many. He mentored many. Many of whom he mentored and empowered started their own small little businesses. This is what we call kingdom economics. He was a man of integrity, of the highest order. He always, just to concur with the accountant, I know for the fact, he always paid his creditors on time or before time to hold his credibility, and he paid his staff on time. I don't think there was ever a day when he said his staff going through challenges that he won't be able to pay them, you know, now, or probably give him grace period, but he paid them on time. And I know that he used to spend hours, late hours in the afternoon after everybody's gone and his commitment, you know, to the creditors and everybody else. Everybody's gone home and relaxing. Some of them probably fast asleep. I used to phone him in the evening. He's still at work. He was totally committed. He was a man of truth. His yes is yes and his no is no. He has values. And I'm sure that some of his values and his attributes must have, you know, intermixed with his staff and all those who came in contact with him. We used to relate to each other as brothers and as mentors. We have so much in common. We had so much in common. I used to even drive all the way from Durban to meet him and spend some time encouraging each other. We used to speak for hours on the phone, an hour or so at a time on the phone, and talking about us being relevant in our faith. Relevant outside the four walls of the building to fulfill the Great Commission. His personality, hospitality, Sister Mumsy's hospitality and the love speaks volumes about the caliber of the Nair family. He had such a generous heart. And often I use the word lavish generosity, because Tim was that caliber of person. He realized that the Lord Jesus Christ lavishly gave his life for him. So in return, the generosity that I could actually say that he had was lavish generosity for the kingdom. Whenever he gets wind of what we do, of our humanitarian, our outreach endeavors, church planting, both locally and globally, he used to always deposit monies in the mission account, because he knew who he was in Christ, and he knew where his heart lied. And he always commended us. He would not phone at any time and leave without leaving a word of commendation and encouragement. He was a great sower in the kingdom. And I remember, and I know that he generously kept his pledge to Christ for All Nations, Reinhard Bonnke's ministry, up until the very end. As I said, his yes is yes and no is no. I remember some of the words that he, whenever I have conversations with him on the phone, I just quote. Always, I quote, he says, no matter what we're going through, but God is faithful. I won't forget the word that is used. And God never lets us down. In spite of the challenges that the business and society threw at him, his faith was so strong, and he became an overcomer. He was an excellent and astute businessman and a colleague of mine. He was a member of our Christian Business Forum in Durban. And when I invited him for our launch a few years ago of our ICBF, Imperial Christian Business Fellowship, he was so excited. And he said he will never miss this meeting for anything. He was so humble when I asked him to sit on the table amongst prominent, very powerful key speakers in our business forum. He was so humble, yet he stood so tall. Every man has a story. Every man has a journey in life. And I'm so proud to have been part of Tim's journey. His testimony, as Pastor prayed initially, was very powerful. I always encouraged him, write a book, because your book will impact thousands of people. Now, when we go to a cemetery, to a gravesite, we see lots of tombstones. And on the tombstone, we find the name of the deceased. We also find written there date of birth. And then we have a big dash and the date of his death, that individual's death. God is not interested in the day you were born. God is not interested in what you, on the day you have deceased, but God is interested in the dash years of your life. Between when you were born and when God calls you away. What you did and what you didn't do in the dash years whilst you were here, God will reveal that in eternity. I can proudly say that Tim impacted and touched many lives. He used his resources to extend God's kingdom during the dash years, his journey in life. And I could say, I'm proud to have been part of his journey in his life. During the dash years. And today we could proudly say, O death, where is your sting? O grave, where is your victory? For our brother Tim has graduated from earth to eternal life, to a place where God has prepared for him. Tim gave in to a higher calling in the midst of our prayer. Lord, heal him, restore his health. But he gave in to a higher calling. And as we all know, the angels must have welcomed him. And the Lord says, welcome, my good and faithful servant. Precious in the eyes of the Lord is the death of his saints. Now, there are two meanings of the word precious. Firstly, it means costly. Costly in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. Costly in the sight of the Lord was the death of Tim. The death of every God's saints are costly. Secondly, precious means highly valued. Highly valued in the sight of the Lord is the death of all his saints. And again, highly valued in the sight of the Lord is the life of my brother Tim and the death of brother Tim. Jesus paid a high price, a costly price, a valued life. And we could not repay this debt. And I know exactly the way Tim felt about this. In closing, goodbye for now, my brother. Servant of the Most High God, until then, you'll always be remembered for who you are and what you meant to us all and to the body of Christ. You indeed left a legacy. There is only one word that we will never hear in heaven. We will not hear this one word in heaven, goodbye. We will never, we are there to live and spend eternity together. And for now, my fellow soldier, my brother, see you on the other side. Thank you, Logan.
Thank you, Pastor Les. Truly, Uncle Tim was a man who knew how to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. It's now my privilege to call upon Larry Seethal, who was Uncle Tim's legal advisor and also a very close family friend, to pay a tribute on behalf of Uncle Tim. Larry.
Thank you, Master of Ceremonies. I sat in the back and I was admiring this huge smile on Tim, and he must be wondering, and I believe by my faith he's with us, and he must be wondering, after those five tributes, Larry, Logan, Bill, Vinesh, and Pastor Lazarus, what are you going to do now? And so today I've listened to all these wonderful tributes. A lot of that has been said, was part of what I wanted to say. But I want to just say this much today, and that is, all of us seated here today know that if anything is certain in life, it's death. Nothing else. And whilst we stand here and pay these wonderful tributes to those that have left us behind, we fail to realize that we should be doing this and paying these tributes and giving these accolades to those very ones that are with us in life, so that they themselves hear it. They themselves appreciate these accolades that come to them. And accolades like this is not just about how well I have done in my life, but it's how well that I could do for my brothers and sisters. To me, Tim was not only my client, but he was my close and personal friend. We spent many hours, as Mumsy will tell you, in my boardroom, discussing, as Billy said earlier, discussing God, and as Vinesha said, but also discussing issues pertaining to his life and business. On the 22nd of February this year was one of those dates that I set to meet him at my office to discuss a few issues. At 11:28 that morning, he sent me a WhatsApp message. And this is typical Tim, and I quote his words. "Good day, Larry, typical gentleman. I cannot meet this afternoon. I have some COVID symptoms." This is the man who's sick saying to me, "Oxygen and temperature, excellent. However, doing some blood tests at Margaret Hospital for peace of mind. I am 65 and I don't want to take risks. Apologies, Tim." I replied to that message and thought I would reschedule that appointment. Never did I think that I would be standing here today and paying tribute to a man of Tim's caliber. For me, in my interactions with Tim, he had this impeccable character. Please don't misunderstand me. He also had his own human weaknesses, but he still maintained an impeccable character. And when I reflect on those words, on his impeccable character, I think of all the things that you and I have heard this afternoon, that he has done for others, that he has helped others. Tim carried his name on the hearts of each one of us that are here today. Forget about putting his name on a tombstone on marble. No, Tim's name is imprinted in each one of you here in your heart, because he means and he meant something to each one of us. Tim, we remember that what he has done for us and what he has done for others would remain immortal. This is the Tim that I knew. As we heard from Vinesh, he never worried about the car that he drove or where he stayed. He was more interested in what he could do for others, often to the verge of falling out of favor with those whom he tried to help. To me, Tim was a role model, not only to his immediate family, but to his extended family, his colleagues, his employees, his friends, and of course, his brothers. His brothers meant the world to him. He spoke about his brothers with untold dying love and how much they meant to him and to his family. He spoke about the Nair name being where it started off in a, and I didn't know this, in a shop in town and all the things that went on in that shop, and how life proceeded and progressed, and how the Nair brothers grew to be the successful businessmen that they are today. He was very, very proud of each one of his brothers and their achievements, even those that have passed on. He understood that infinite striving to be the best is man's duty. It is his own reward, and he accepted it with his undying faith that everything else is left up to God, not him. He made sure that it was his duty to be the best husband, Mamsi, the best father to the children, the best employer, the best brother to his brothers, the best grandfather, and also the best friend to Jason and those that were with him. And he knew and accepted that everything else, as we heard Pastor Lazarus saying, was in God's hand. So as I stand here today, I want us, as Tim's friends and family, not to let his life and his memories fade into oblivion. Let us take a lesson from his life, and let us, whether we are his friends, his family, or his brothers, let us play the role that he wanted to play in our lives. To Mumsy and the children from my family and my extended family, I want to say that the loss of Tim can never be measured at all. But what he had given to you in the dash, as we heard Pastor Lazarus saying, you can never, ever measure. May God be with you and comfort you in this time. And remember that all of us here today are here for you and your family. God bless.
Thank you, Larry. As Larry said, Uncle Tim's life was really about others. He always made sure that he put others first, and we are really, really grateful and thankful for that. We're now going to have Lizanne Nair, who's also his niece, to play or sing a special song. And Uncle Tim loved every time she sang, and I know today as well it's going to be such a blessing. Thank you, Lizanne.
Hello, everybody. It's an absolute honor for me to pay tribute to my uncle through song. For those of you who know me, you know that I absolutely adore Elvis Presley. And Uncle Tim shared that love as well for Elvis. But he kind of lost me with another artist that he had a fascination with, and that was Mahalia Jackson. Now, he pointed her out to me when I was about 8 or 9 years old on this old program, I don't know if you remember it, called Gospel Gold. And I looked up and I saw this big, okay, it sounds a little hypocritical with me saying big lady, but she was this big, powerful looking lady. And when she sang, it's something moved you, but she looked so plain. There was no makeup, no fancy dresses or fancy frills. And I couldn't understand it. You know, when you're young and immature, you think about the way a person looks as well. But I just never understood it. But over the years, I grew to appreciate her music and understand why she is the queen of gospel, even though she's been gone many decades. So today, I'm going to try to sing one of her songs. And I chose this because I sang this once in church, and Uncle Tim made sure he caught me at the back in the foyer to tell me that that's the kind of music I should be singing. And you can't go wrong with the old songs. So I'm going to sing that today.
Sure, Lord,
dear Jesus, let it be.
Wow, thank you, Liz. Uncle Tim certainly enjoyed that, and so did we. And that was really his heart, just a closer walk with the Lord. Every time you spoke to Uncle Tim, that was really, really his passion and his heart. Thank you again. We have a few more tributes. We've also had some written tributes, and you'll pardon me due to time. I'm going to pass some of them on to the family. I won't be able to read them due to time. We've received a tribute from Pastor Siva. We've received a tribute from retired brigadier and advocate Thamba Marimutu, who was a close friend of the family. And we also received a tribute from Mr. Kool and Simonier, and I'm going to read those two before we go on to the family for further tributes this afternoon. A tribute from Mr. Kool. It is sometimes very difficult to put into words the impact that someone has had on your life, and that is true with Tim. Tim was foremost a child of God, and this bore out in how he spent his time at Mr. Kool. He treated everyone that crossed his path with the dignity and respect that was expected. It did not matter if you arrived in a Mercedes or by foot. The staff members were treated as equals, no matter your position. From the managers to the cleaners, Tim would always speak to you as he would have liked you to speak to him. Tim always gave his best at work and led by example, and he expected all of us to live up to the example that he was setting. If he could, then you could. If he was at work on time, shaved and dressed neatly, then it was expected that you should be too. Through the example that he was setting, he would teach us all valuable life lessons that would stay with us through our lives. If you worked under Tim, you would be guaranteed to grow as a person whether you liked it or not. Tim was also a dedicated family man, and his love for his family was always evident when he spoke of them. When he spoke of Mumsy, you could always hear the love and respect he had for her, and would always tell us how thankful he was that he had a lady like her in his life. Just like Tim helped us staff to grow in life, Mumsy had the same effect on Tim's life. Tim was also very proud of his children, the eldest two, Mervyn and Melissa, who was very dear to him, and his youngest sons, Quinton and Kaelin, whom he was extremely proud of. He was especially proud of the men they became. Quinton, you were a shining example in your father's eyes. From the young boy that spent his holidays working at Mr. Kool to the quiet, strong man that you are today, there is a lot of your father in you. Kaelin, you were the joy in your father's heart, and he always understood your gentle soul and your naughty nature. He would always shake his head and say, "Hey, that boy of mine, what am I going to do with him?" and have a little giggle to himself. Tim's other great love of his life was Mr. Kool Air Conditioning, that he spent a great part of his life building to the great company it is today. It is difficult to put into words how proud Tim was of his company, and it was a particular pleasure for Tim to see staff members grow because of his Mr. Kool. Tim would always say he was blessed to be a blesser, and that God had honored him to be in that position. From all the staff at Mr. Kool, we'd like to thank Tim for the endless and tireless work you did, sometimes 7 days a week, to make sure that there was money to pay our salaries so that we could put a plate of food on the table for our families. We would also like to convey our endless gratitude to Tim's family for the time that Tim spent away from them with his other family at Mr. Kool. It was an honor and privilege for all of us. You were a boss that was really loved and respected by your staff, and your space at work will never be filled. You will always be remembered and honored by all of us. There will always be one captain of the ship. And only Simonier and Mr. Kool's staff will understand that orange ballpoint pen will be retired forever. God bless Tim and his family as they have blessed us at Mr. Cool. Thank you, Mr. Cool. And then from Simonia Clutch and Break, a golden heart stopped beating, hardworking hands now at rest. Our hearts are broken to prove that the Almighty only takes the best. You fought a good fight as a God-fearing man. We as your staff are at a loss of words. We hoped and pray that you were going to come back to us. But now you are in a better place, resting in the Father's arms. We cherish the good times we had, everything you taught us, even the many times you reprimanded us. You were our father, boss, advisor, and grandfather to our children. We can no longer see you with our eyes, but we will forever feel you in our hearts. We will forever miss you, greatly missed and loved from all the staff at Simonia Clutch and Break. That speaks for itself, a family. We're now going to move on to the family tributes and to pay tribute on behalf of Uncle Tim's nephews and nieces. I'm going to call upon Kethan Nair. Kethan, over to you.
Good afternoon, dear family and friends. I greet you all in the wonderful and precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It is indeed an honor and a privilege to pay tribute on behalf of Uncle Tim, the legend that we have all come to know and well respect. Uncle Tim was an extraordinary man who, in his own unique way, made an impact on so many people's lives. And not just that of his immediate family, but to us, his nieces and nephews. To many, he was a second father, the person we go to in our time of need, and to have the confidence to know that he will make right in our troubled situations. A reason to give God praise for the life of a magnificent man and for the legacy that he has left behind. Uncle Tim has inspired in each one of us the value of hard work and how to make big dreams come true. He was a man that came from humble beginnings, a man who knew what hard work was, and how to dream big, but with a vision to make those dreams come true. He was blessed with wisdom that led him to become one of the greatest success stories the small town of Pochefstroom has known. A story that has inspired us all to never give up in the face of adversity and to keep persevering against all odds. He taught us that no matter where you come from and no matter what your past may look like, it doesn't define you. Because Uncle Tim proved that when you partner with God, you can only achieve success. From a storeman at Mr. Cool to becoming the owner of Mr. Cool. From a convicted prisoner to one of the most meticulous and successful businessmen in Pochefstroom. That is what this faith achieved for him. I firmly believe that the verse found in Colossians 3, verse 23, which says, "Whatever you do, do it heartily, as to the Lord and not to men," is the perfect reflection of Uncle Tim's work ethic, making him a perfectionist who worked with wisdom to becoming the great problem solver that he indeed was. Apart from his great success, he was a man who showed love in many ways, especially to us, his dear family. He always valued the family unit as something essential in life. Now, some of the cousins will remember how in the early 90s, when he introduced some of us to Auntie Mummy, and even though he didn't need our approval, he still asked, as little as we were, if we approved. This bears proof to the value he saw in his family, as well as the respect that he had for them. Now, even though Uncle Tim was extremely dedicated to his work, he always made family his priority, doing the best for us wherever he could. Uncle Tim had this bold and loving personality that was present during family functions. When we gathered at Mbango with Amma every Sunday, he had this knack of making every Christmas, birthday dinner, family get-together special. He turned everyday family events into special occasions that'll live in our hearts. Through both good and bad times, Uncle Tim was the one that could always be counted on, a pillar of strength that the entire family came to depend on, and many times a brightly shining star that led the way to peace and harmony in the family. Uncle Tim was so involved in making sure the family plans are adhered to that for Logan and Pupsy's wedding, Uncle Tim visited them every Friday for 1 year prior to the wedding. One thing I know is that Uncle Tim showed us how to love and care for family. His heart was set on having our family together in unity. Uncle Tim's life was one that probably taught us the most valuable lesson in life: put God first. Uncle Tim was not just a spectator who sat in the Sunday service. No. Uncle Tim was active in the ministry. He had this generous heart that no matter what your situation you may be in, he would go out of his way to go and meet those in need. Uncle Tim was blessed to be a blessing. He was a man who did things in secret and for which God rewarded him publicly. He wasn't just an ordinary person, but he was an asset to the church and to the community. Helping in any way possible, from organizing t-shirts for the surfer club, or getting Auntie Mummy to cook pots of biryani for the kids in the church, to blessing different organizations or different churches of faith, because from a young age he understood the importance of the good news of Jesus Christ. Now, as I come to the conclusion of this tribute that barely encompasses the outstanding man that my Uncle Tim was, I hope that all here today remember the humble acts that he had performed, which in one way or the other has touched each and every one of our lives. From his generous contributions to the simple smile that he put on our faces. Let us remember the legendary legacy that Uncle Tim leaves behind. We are all grateful to have been surrounded by his presence and blessings for all these years. I hope to continue to carry on with the teachings that he has instilled within us and to do proud the great legacy that he has left behind. And to end, I'd like to say, farewell, my dearest uncle. May your soul rest in eternal peace. God bless and thank you.
Thank you, Ketan. Uncle Tim really loved all his nephews and nieces, and it was so, so evident in all our lives. Uncle Tim loved family, as you heard. Whenever we had a family get together at his home, he will make sure that even Auntie Mommy's family was there. He loved them, as siblings, brothers, sisters. And to speak on behalf of the Reddy family today, it's my privilege to call upon Yugeshni Pillay. Yugeshni.
I greet you all in the wonderful name of Jesus. I never would have thought that I'll actually be giving a tribute so close to home, but someday it all happens to every one of us. I just want to thank you, Mr. Program Director, for giving me this opportunity. And family and friends, today we come together not only to mourn, but to celebrate the life of Uncle Tim. It is indeed an absolute honor and privilege for me to be able to pay a tribute to a man who is worthy of all honor, respect, and reverence on behalf of the Reddy R. Pillay and Govender family. Albert Einstein once said, and I quote, "The value of a man should be seen in what he gives and not in what he is able to receive," I unquote. That statement alone is a reflection of the kind of man Uncle Tim was. He embodied everything that is good and righteous. He was a man who gave his very best to us all. His was a life that demands notice, a life that exemplified intelligence, a life that inspired emulation, a life that burned so that others' paths were set ablaze. He was a strategic thinker, a visionary who was brilliant, innovative, and creative. These character traits ensured his success as an entrepreneur. Above all, his vast achievements, what made him truly successful, was his great love for people. He could relate to everyone. He was able to break any age and cultural barrier with such ease, respect, and hospitality. We thank the God Almighty for this wonderful man whose faith in our Lord was so strong, whose love for his wife and family was obvious, and whose friendship was endearing. Today we can all bear witness to the outpouring of love and admiration for him. This has been inspiring and heartwarming. We are all united in our love for Uncle Tim, who to me was the very essence of a strong yet a gentleman, because there is nothing as strong as gentleness and nothing as gentle as real emotional strength. It's a little story about my Uncle Nanda, who could recall when my Auntie Cookie, who's his wife, worked at Mr. Cool. And every time, every Friday, they had a social, which they played pool. So he always took my uncle as his partner. So my uncle, big-headed, he thought that it was because of his skill in pool, which he didn't have any skill. But anyway, later he found out that the only reason that Uncle Tim chose Uncle Nanda to be his partner was because Auntie Cookie had introduced Auntie Mummy, who's his sister, to Uncle Tim already to get into the good books. But, you know, he always encouraged the family and the younger ones especially to concentrate on education, to grow in their spiritual journey with the Lord, and even in their business ventures. He stood firm on godly principles and values. This is what he imparted into our lives as a family. Having his wisdom and guidance was priceless. My cousin Gresham, who you'd see that, you know, he always went on them, on their trips. He just wants to pay a small tribute, and this is how it goes. My dear Uncle Tim, you were not just an uncle to me, but more like a second father. You have always included me in almost everything, whether it was our Friday braais or family holidays. We have been exploring the Drakensberg together for almost 15 years. I grew up with Quentin and Kaelin, who I consider brothers rather than cousins. And that's one of the reasons you considered me a son. You always advised us on life and our future, and you always put us back in line when we overstepped. I was always in awe in what a knowledgeable man you were. I just want you to know that everything you taught me shaped me into the man I am today. You will be greatly missed. I promise to always look out for Quentin and Kaelin. I just want to thank you for everything you've done for my family and I. But most importantly, I want to thank you for always including me. As a family, we will forever be indebted to Uncle Tim for setting a shining example, indebted to Uncle Tim for setting a shining example of unconditional love as a devoted husband to Auntie Mummy and a great father to his children. You know, watching my aunt over the past few years, so many years that she was married to him, I've never seen her so happy. She did everything to make her happy. He devoted himself to her. And I remember all my messages to her on a birthday of no matter what it was, and I always used to tell her, you are my mentor. And I only wish that I could be half the wife that you are, because she was so good to him. And then I only wish that I could have a husband like Uncle Tim, which I do have one now, and he's getting there slowly, thanks to Uncle Tim. You know, it's just a funny story. Why are we touching on that? Sorry, I'm going to be finished now, I promise you. So Uncle Tim likes Benny Hinn and the older music. So I'm the younger generation. So my husband learned that after he met Uncle Tim. And then he starts playing Benny Hinn when we go to sleep, because we always play like worship music and stuff. So I'm like, what are you playing? And he's like, Benny Hinn, because Uncle Tim likes it. And so he heard it and he started liking it. And then I realized, Benny Hinn is so like calm, that actually helps you fall asleep. So the music that Uncle Tim, like, not only, okay, that sounded a bit, but it calms you, it relaxes you. And then I realized why he actually liked it, because it was so calming and it gave you so much of peace. But I just want to say to my auntie, Mommy, Quentin, Kaelin. I know this is the most difficult thing that you guys have to go through, and there isn't words that I could actually say to comfort you, but I just want to leave you with this, that everyone may leave you, but God will never leave you. And Uncle Tim really has left a lot behind for you in terms of the relationships that he built, and you are never alone. The family is always here with you, and just be strong and know that should you ever need anything, even if it's just someone to talk to, we all are here for you. And to my dear uncle, just want to say, you have fought the good fight, and you have run the race, and you've done well. And we are so extremely proud of you, and we just thank God that we got to know you, because the person that you are is just unexplainable, because you're so brilliant. Thank you. God bless you all.
Thank you, Yogeshni. Uncle Tim truly gave more than he received. Well, you heard how Uncle Tim loved his siblings, and to pay a tribute on behalf of all the siblings, I'm going to call upon Jade Daniels, who's his only sister, Prissy, Prissy's daughter, and Jade Daniels is going to play a tribute on behalf of all the siblings. Jade.
Thank you, Master of Ceremonies, for affording me the opportunity to pay a tribute to our late Uncle Tim on behalf of his brothers and sister. To my dearest brother, you've left us with some fond memories and outstanding love. You are truly a brother's keeper. Words cannot be sufficient enough for all the blessings you have bestowed upon me and my family. You are truly a blessing to me. As an elder brother, I am broken. You will forever be engraved on my heart. Go well, my dearest brother. See you in the morning. Love, Ron. Tim, I'm going to miss our Sunday tea and our long chats after church. You are a generous soul. Your love for the church and family always touched my heart. You are a very meticulous person. Whatever you did, you did it with excellence. You were always the caring and loving brother, someone I could always come to for advice. It is with a heavy heart that I must bid you farewell. Farewell, brother, but it won't be forever. Until we meet again, your loving brother, Pete. Tim, you were the brother we could always count on. You've helped me in many ways. You were instrumental in not only my life, but my children's as well. Your doors were always open. You were caring and giving. Little did I know that you would be taken away from us. I have fond memories of when we were little, like the time you were electrocuted and Mom had to pull you out of the stove. You then went on to become very quick-witted. I will remember you always, Charlie. Tim, you were always a person who stood for the truth, no matter if it was against your own family members. Whatever you did it with excellence. You took your past failures and made yourself a very successful man. Wherever I go and everyone I speak to, speak nothing but highly of you. You've left such a legacy that it'll be hard, even for us, to compete with. Thank you for your brotherly support. You will be forever cherished. Love, James. To my darling brother, the tears cannot stop flowing. It is hard to imagine my life without you. Thank you for choosing me 52 years ago and changing my destiny. Our bond was not that of blood and DNA, but a bond of love that was stronger than any glue. Thank you for being a brother to me and a father to me. Thank you for loving me unconditionally. Thank you for instilling character in my children, for teaching them the value of education and family, for speaking greatness into their lives. Thank you for everything you have done for me. You will forever be in my heart, and I will forever be your little sister. So I will not say goodbye, but rather see you when I see you. Love your sister, Pris. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jade. I'm now going to request that we all stand as we're going to sing the next hymn led by Lizanne. Thank you, Lizanne.
Consider all.
Lord, we declare your greatness. You alone are great. You alone are Alpha. You alone are Omega. You are the beginning and the end. Father, we praise your name. We glorify your name. Because no one else deserves all the glory but you alone. We love you. We appreciate you. And we thank you that you are our daddy. You are our papa. You are our father. And in you alone we hope and trust. May your name be glorified and praised. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You may be seated, family. It is now my privilege to call upon Pastor Trevor Downham to deliver the word of the Lord. And we thank God for this opportunity that we could hear from the Lord this morning or afternoon. Thank you. Thank you, Pastor Trevor.
Hi, everybody. Wow, what a day. We on there. What a day. What an incredible privilege, Mumsy. Guys, thank you for this opportunity to be able to share a few words with you. I know our time is going, so I'm going to keep this as short as I can. But there is something I want to say and to point out to you today. And I think the best way that I could kind of encapsulate it in light of all that you have heard, you've heard of an incredibly good man, a man who's left a mark in so many people's life, a man who loved his staff, a man who adored his wife and his kids, a man who was so great for the community and loved his church. And we have said much of Tim today, but I'm sure Tim is going to start saying, when's somebody going to say something about God? You know, and I'm going to say something about God, because this is what I think in the context of Tim's life, that as much as Tim was a blessing, we all know that there is no substitute for the blessing of God. No substitute. Tim was a good man. He did some great things. He was a wonderful partner, a wonderful friend, but I'm sure he would be the first to tell you there is no substitute for the blessing of God. And generally, when there is a blessing of God, it's because somebody has done something right, in which case Tim quite obviously has. But the family have asked me to share with you just a few thoughts from Psalm 1. And I'm sure that it is, when I asked Mumsy and the guys what they wanted me to talk about, it wasn't even a second before they said, man, Psalm 1 is one of Tim's favorite passages, and it's all about the life that God blesses. If there's no substitute for the blessing of God, then Tim's life is a great picture of the life that God blesses. Here's what it said. Blessed is the man, we could put Tim's name in there, who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the seat of mockers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree. That's a great picture. He's like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever he does prospers. Is that not an incredible picture of our brother Tim's life? A man who was blessed of God. A man who the picture of somebody planted intentionally is not a happened by accident. God intentionally planted this man by the streams of water, and his life bore much fruit. Such was the story of Tim Nair's life. But there are other things we read there in the passage. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, or walks in the way of the mockers. And we know that Tim did not do that thing, and that would have brought along an attraction to God that there's a man who needs my blessing. There's a man who has done everything Psalm 1 has said, and he would have said, angel, go and bless that man. And indeed, we are here today, and many have been blessed as a result of the good life of Tim. But I want to add a couple of other things to this thing, because the passage that we've read leaves us with words for a great legacy of your dad. You know, a great legacy of a man who didn't do the things that the psalm said and did do the things that the psalm said. But I want to suggest to you, too, that blessed, too, is the man who has the sins forgiven. This is a simple truth. Blessed is the man who has the blessing of God because he knows that he is forgiven. If there's one thing the world right now needs, and one thing the world is crying out in every individual in the world, it's not better politics, it's not more money, it's not the answer to the coronavirus. Everybody needs forgiveness. And the beauty of Tim's life is that he found forgiveness. And it was on the foundation of God's forgiveness for him and his forgiveness of the people around him, which I'm sure was necessary from time to time, that gave him the foundation on which to build so great a life. Blessed is the man whose sins are forgiven. Let me add to that. Blessed is the man who's willing to trust God. God will never force you to trust him. You have to be willing to trust him in every circumstance of life. And we all know that Tim, and we painted a beautiful picture of him, but we know that he went through ups and downs. We know that he had serious challenges over the course of time. We know the story of his life, and it incorporated many ups and many downs. But one thing Tim understood was that blessed is the man who learns what it means to trust God in every situation. It's easy to trust God when things are going well, isn't it? But it's not easy to trust God when things are not going well, and to weather the storms of poor economy and challenges of the virus and in latter days. And yet Tim was able to, like Jairus, when Jairus was walking with Jesus, and Jairus is saying to Jesus, "Jesus, what are you going to do when we get to my house? My daughter is dying." And then he sees the mourners, and they come to Jairus and say, "Don't bother Jesus anymore because your daughter is dead." And Jesus says to Jairus, "Jairus, don't listen to them. Just trust me." "But Lord, they've said these things, and they've seen the evidence. They know what it is." And Jesus would have said to Jairus, "Jairus, don't listen to them. Just trust me." And he knew what it meant, and he knew the feeling and the sense of wow, man, I've got to learn what it means to really, really trust God through all the challenges and all the issues of life. Thirdly, I add to this, blessed is the man who goes the extra mile. Everybody in every single tribute today has spoken about Tim's extra mile lifestyle. From the kids, you know, right the way through to the business people, to the bank, to the community, to his staff. Everybody has spoken about a man who understood in biblical terms what it meant to go the extra mile. And I guess that's why Jesus made such a hero of people like the Good Samaritan. He didn't just go 1 mile and get down into the gutter with the guy, put a bit of Dettol on his wounds and say, "Well, I've done my bit." He didn't just do that. He said to the man, "I will now put you on my donkey, and I will take you to the inn, and I will give the innkeeper money to keep you well until you are well again." You see, Tim was like that. And blessed is the man who goes the extra mile when nobody else really knows about it. I have learned a lot today just listening to the stories of Tim's life. He was an extra, extra mile person to the point of his generosity in so many beautiful, beautiful ways. Blessed is the man who ends his life as significant and not just successful. And that's terminology we use in our church quite a bit. You see, successful people are a dime a dozen. There are lots of them. But there's only a handful of significant ones. And the difference between successful people and significant people is that significant people have a willingness to sacrifice their success for the betterment of the people around them. That's what makes them significant. So when we talk about Tim's success, I understand what you're saying, and I have nothing against it, and I get the terminology well. But I need to tell you, Tim was a whole lot more than just a successful businessman, a successful father, a successful community member. He was a significant one because he understood the place of sacrifice. Jesus could have been a successful king. In fact, there's one place in the gospel where they wanted to make Jesus the king. And Jesus walked through the crowd. He stunned them all. He left them. And they would have said, "Jesus, don't you want to be our king?" And Jesus said, "No, I don't want to be a successful king. I've come to be a significant savior." And the way you become a significant savior is not doing anything other than sacrificing your success. And so Jesus sacrificed his success to be a significant savior for each one of us. Blessed is the man who can end his life as significant. Let me go on a few more. Blessed is the man who loves his wife and his family. He was blessed by you, Mumsy. You were a blessing to him. And getting to know you and just the guys and a little bit of who you are and what your guys are, man, he was blessed to have you because you were awesome and you are awesome. Blessed is he who is concerned for his staff and his business. He took you guys very seriously. He spoke often of you in conversations I had. He spoke about how well you did and how significant you were to him, and he always wanted the best for you. I know he was a hard man sometimes. You know, he was a principled man. You don't mess with Tim Nye. You know, you understood that. You didn't mess with this guy. But he loved you. He was committed to your well-being, and he applauded you continually in conversations that I know Billy as well have had with him. Blessed is the man who loves his church. Man, Tim Nye loved church. Used to sit over there every weekend, Mums, and he would always be there beautifully dressed. And this is a Tim Nye suit, by the way. Tim Nye was not happy with the way I dressed. So he says to Mumsy, Mumsy, you need to take this guy shopping. So Mumsy took Helene and I bought my Tim Nye suit. It looks good. He was concerned for so many things. He loved his church. He was committed to his pastors. He was just the perfect parishioner, if that's the right word for today. Tim Nye was awesome in love with his church. Tim loved God's word. He really did. He loved God's word. He meditated on it day and night. That's what made him a tree that was fruitful. Tim Nye, and I could go on forever, but I'm done now. Tim Nye was a man who finished well. He finished really well. He did, as somebody said, he fought the good fight. Hey, you know, I was with him on the last day of his life, and Tim was fighting even then. He kept the faith right to the end. I wonder if we'll be able to say that. So many of us lose the faith or give it away or just drop it along the wayside. Tim Nye kept the faith right to the end. He ran well with perseverance the race that was set before him. And because of this, I can say to you, blessed is the man who has a great story to tell to God. Because you do know we all have to stand before God one day, and every one of us is going to be given the opportunity to tell the story of our lives. We know this from the parable Jesus told about the rich man who gave talents, and there came a day of accounting where they would have to stand before the king, and they would have to account for that which they had been given. And the king would say, what did you do with what I gave you? Some of them had a good story. Two of them had a good story to tell, but one didn't. I'm not going to tell you, Tim Nye had a great story to tell to God. He may well be telling it now, you know, in the context of human time. It's not really, but Tim lived his life so well that he has a great story to tell. Then lastly, blessed is he who goes to heaven. Heaven. Just one thought about heaven. Jesus, the book of John, with his disciples, he said to his disciples as they were perplexed and really worried about what was going to be happening, because he told them that he was soon to die, and they didn't understand this. And Jesus said, do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in me, trust in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. I go to prepare a place for you, that you may be where I am. Think about that for a moment. Don't we often pray, Lord, will you please be with me? Now we go to a place where we don't have to pray that anymore, because he said, I prepare a place that you can be where I am. And there's a difference. Down here on earth, we say, Lord, will you be with me? But there will come a time when we will be with him. And we call that beautiful place heaven. In Revelation 14, verse 13, it culminates this whole blessed thing. It says this. This is the Apostle John as he writes. He said, I heard a voice from heaven say, write this. Blessed. There's the word again. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Tim Nair continues to be blessed today. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Blessed indeed, says the Spirit, that they may rest from their labor, for their deeds follow them. I like that part where he said, blessed indeed. That means it's because of something that has happened. And as Tim has lived his life, had a great story, blessed in so many ways, in so many areas, he now enjoys blessed rest in the presence of the Jesus that he loved. We will miss him. We surely will. He was a fine man. A fine man. And we will continue to love him. But he's in heaven, and his blessing continues today. Can we just pray? Father, we want to thank you for the beauty of this life that we have remembered today. Man, what an awesome tribute. What an incredible legacy Tim has left for his children and for his relatives and for his nieces and nephews and for his brothers. What a great legacy he has left for them. And Lord, I want to pray that we would learn from this, that these 2 hours that we have sat here would not just be a nice sentimental time, but that we would take these thoughts and turn them into something significant in our own lives. We thank you for him. Thank you for every life that he touched, for every word that he said, for every person he encouraged, for every challenge that he brought to the people who he worked with and the church and the people that he knew. We will surely miss him today, but thank you, God, that his blessing continues on even now because he is in heaven. That's amazing. And we thank you for it. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Trevor. Yes, let our lives be significant. Success is not what the world needs. The world has too much of knowledge. And the Bible says that knowledge puffs up. Knowledge can't solve our solutions. But may we lead lives that are significant. Amen. Thank you, Pastor Trevor. At this point in the program, we're going to sing the next hymn, When the Roll is Called Up Yonder. And I'd like for you to stand as we sing together, When the Roll is Called Up Yonder. I'll be there.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. On that bright and cloudless morning, when the dead in Christ shall rise, and the glory of his resurrection share, gather to their home beyond the skies, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder.
you, Father. You may be seated. Thank you. We're now going to do the vote of thanks, and to do that, I'm going to also call one of Uncle Timmy's favorite nephews, Sebastian Daniels, to pass the vote of thanks. Thank you, Sebastian.
Thank you, Master of Ceremonies, for affording me the opportunity to give thanks to some very special people on behalf of the Tim Nair family. If I have forgotten to mention a few of you, please forgive me. First and foremost, I would like to give thanks to Adonai, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, for his gracious love and mercy towards us all. A special thanks to the pastors and leadership of the Norwegian Settlers Church for their venue and affording Uncle Tim the highest honor of being laid to rest on their grounds. The family would like to say a special thanks to the following doctors: Vishal Maharaj, Kevin Naidu, and Gerald Nanak, who tirelessly took care of him, and to the staff at the Hibiscus Hospital, a heartfelt thanks. And to family and friends for your prayers, love, support, and your contribution in monetary, flowers, and meals. You all are loved and appreciated. And to Bearchus Funeral Service for their excellent service. And to Traffic Department and Laser for giving their time and services. To the caterer for the lovely meals they have provided. Last but not least, to the Mr. Call team for pulling together and continuing the excellent service without Uncle Tim. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sebastian. We now proceed to the reading of the obituary, which is also at the back of your program if you'd like to follow. Timothy Nair was an astute businessman, devoted husband, father, and was a lifelong resident of Port Shepstone, who was called to glory on the 22nd of March 2021 at the age of 65. Timothy was born to the late Mr. and Mrs. Dick Nair on the 24th of November 1955. He was one of seven children. He started his primary school at Port Shepstone Primary and went on to complete his high school education at Port Shepstone Secondary. After school, he loved to help his dad at the tea room. He had later successfully completed his BA degree in law and went on further to complete his MBA or Master of Business Administration. Timothy was a well-respected, hard-working, and dedicated employee of Shamus Rennie for many years. His dedication to his place of employment was of such a nature that him, together with three other employees, were given the opportunity to purchase the company, which was the beginning of Mr. Cool in 1993. Timothy, being self-driven, highly motivated person that he was, went on to be a sole owner of Mr. Cool. He later went on to open a second company, Simonier Clutch and Brake. Mr. Cool was his pride and joy, and he pushed so much energy into this company, making it one of the leading house of air conditioners on the South Coast. He loved his employees, and soon under his leadership, many of them regarded him more of a father than a boss. In 1993, Timothy married the love of his life, Mumsy, who he adored. They had a great bond and deep love for each other, which was clearly evident in their lives. They had become an aspiring example to all those around them. He has four children: Mervyn, Melissa, Quinton, and Kaylin, son-in-law Roshan, grandfather to Taryn, Miguel, and Liam. He loved them dearly and did whatever he could to make sure that they were well provided for. Timothy was a spiritual man who loved his church and always had a heart for others. We remember him as a person who always wore a smile on his face and joke on his lips. He will be deeply missed by his friends, family, business associates, staff, and all who knew him. A great soul,
serves everyone all the time. A great soul never dies. He brings us together again and again. Maya Angelou. We're now going to have a special tribute video by Kaylin Quinton and Auntie Mumsy that's going to play. Please enjoy.
My dad passed away this week. I didn't know that he would come so soon. I was hoping I'd have more time to get acquainted with the idea of death and what it means for those of us left behind. I didn't know he was going to leave me at the age of 23, but it was an honor to have him as my father. I hope you never have to experience such a life-altering loss. The truth is, we all will. Death is a part of life, and once it strikes someone you so dearly love, your existence will never be the same. I take comfort in knowing that my dad is no longer in pain, that suffering is no longer something he has to endure. My dad, Timothy Nair, will forever be in my heart until the day it stops beating. And I am grateful that I am becoming more fully realized human being and more caring and compassionate because of my dad. Still, I would forfeit any wisdom for the sake of having him. What is the measure of a man? Is it the amount of money he has, the possessions he owns, or the power he holds? Is it the professional success he has achieved over the years? I don't believe it is any of these things. The true measure of a man is how much love he gives, how selflessly he shares whatever he can do to help others. By this measure, my dad was immeasurable. I lost my dad, but not only in body, not in spirit. This is by far the most painful and heart-ripping, life-altering experience I have enjoyed. But I do my best to remain grateful and be comforted knowing how much my beloved dad positively affected the lives of those. A heart of gold is what every family member and friend has said about my dad, and it's incredible to see just how boundless his reach has been. And my dad left an impact on every person he has met, even strangers who didn't see strangers, who didn't stay strangers very long because he was just so damn friendly. The love my dad spread on this earth continues to grow and will live on. And that is the ultimate measure of any human being. 1 Timothy 3 verse 2 to 5 says, now the overseer is to be above reproach, faithful to his wife, self-controlled, respectable, hospitable, and able to teach. Not given to drunkenness, not violent but gentle. Not quarrelsome, not a lover of money. He must manage his own family well and see that his children obey him. And he must do this so in a manner worthy full of respect. My dad lived up to this. He exceeded that expectation. He could take care of the church and others so well because he first displayed it at home, which is where everything has to start. I love and miss you, Dad, now and forevermore.
Dad, you are someone I looked up to and admired. On that dreadful day, you left my heart broken and you shattered my dreams. I can't imagine my life without you. There was so much I wanted to share and do with you. Now I have to go solo. My only solace is that you are in heavenly bliss. Dad, when I close my eyes, the image of you is all I see. You have sacrificed a lot to make my future brighter, and for that I thank you. I will be sad, Dad, that you will not be at my graduation or my wedding. You will never get to meet and enjoy your grandchildren. Dad, you have left such a legacy that I one day will be so honored to continue. You have left me with such beautiful memories, I will always remember and cherish them. You have left a part of yourself in me, and you have taken my love away with you. So now rest well, Dad, until we meet again.
Your wings were ready, but my heart was not. Today I have to live my life without your smile and tender voice. I always look at the clock, hoping you will walk through the door at any time. I remember you wouldn't be coming home. Your chair sits empty and your paper unread. Then the tears start to flow. I remember that you aren't truly mine because you always belong to God Almighty. I was simply borrowing you, Tim, from your real home, heaven. No matter how successful and happy you were with us on earth, it's nothing compared to your glorious abode. It is not fair that you were taken from us, but I trust in God's will and unfailing love. I see our two handsome sons, and I can't imagine you not being there for Quentin's graduation and their weddings to come. I always thought we would grow whole together, but you decided to be forever young in glory. Today I am jealous of the angels because they get to spend eternity with this beautiful soul. Tim, you were my rock, my superhero, and my love, a blessing to me and so many other people. You left such a legacy that I can only pray and hope that our sons will continue. Tim, thank you for choosing me as your life partner. And thank you for blessing me with a wonderful life and two handsome sons. And this I will cherish always. You might have left us, but you left a little bit of yourself in both Quentin and Kaylin. Even though our family chain has been broken, there are so many memories that you left with me. And when God calls us one by one, the family chain will be complete again. I won't say goodbye, my love, but I will see you later.
Thank you. May we continue to cherish all those beautiful memories. Family and friends, we have now come to the end of this part of the celebration of the life of Uncle Tim. As I said earlier on, it is said that the tragedy of life is not death, but living life without a purpose. And we thank God that we can take lessons from the life of Uncle Tim and make sure that we live lives of purpose. May we imitate Uncle Tim, and as he imitated Jesus Christ. We will now proceed for the committal at the graveside here on the premises. Once completed at the committal, the family has prepared takeaway lunch packs for you available at the foyer. As Uncle Tim would insist, please make sure that you take a lunch pack with you before you leave. Close family are invited to join us at Uncle Tim's home in line with all COVID-19 protocols. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. I now call upon Pastor Johnson Khan to do the concluding prayer for us. Pastor Johnson.
Let us bow for prayer, please. Most gracious God and eternal Father, we thank you for being with us even through this time of bereavement, time of sorrow and pain. Thank you that you are the healer of the brokenhearted, and thank you, Lord, that you are our strength and ever-present help even in time of trouble. So thank you for being with us and even through the service. And we pray, Lord, that even as we're going to continue, Father, be with us, guide us and protect us, and have your will as we would submit unto you now, as we would give you thanks in Jesus' mighty name. We ask all these mercies with much thanksgiving. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Johnson. Pallbearers, would you please take your positions? Thank you. May we please rise? Thank you. God's praise.